Hey y'all, it's 5 after. We're gonna get started.
Not away from the kitchen.
Okay. Welcome everybody on the cold Tuesday night. We are so happy you are here. We usually meet the second Tuesday of every month, but next Tuesday is Valentine's Day. So our board said, we can't have it on Valentine's. So we moved it up to tonight, and it's in the same night as our Chairman's Council from Fulton County is having something. So a lot of our members are there. But thank you all for being here. We've got a wonderful speaker tonight, Deborah Silcox. We're so excited she's here. And we're going to start off, as we always do, with a prayer. So let's, if you'll bow your heads with me. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for this country. We thank you for waking us up on this beautiful day. And Lord, we thank you for the rain. And we thank you for our men and women who are standing in harm's way so that we can be here. We thank you for our law enforcement officers that are standing in harm's way to protect us. Lord, we thank you for our new president and vice president. We are so thankful for Donald J. Trump and Mike Pence, and we just pray your special blessings upon them and your hedge of protection around them. We thank you for Deborah Silcox and putting herself out there to run for this district and winning and putting herself out there is not easy. And we thank you, God, for her servant's heart. We thank you for what she is going to accomplish down there under that gold dome. We pray you would protect her and her husband and her precious children and just use her mightily, Lord, for your kingdom. Lord, I thank you for every member of this club, those who couldn't be here tonight. We pray your blessing over them, and we thank you for Cross Creek. They're always such a wonderful blessing to us, and we pray you would bless Sharon and Cheryl and all the girls here. And Lord, we thank you for this time to be together, and I ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
All right, Jim, would you like to lead us in the pledge?
Yes. Everybody, please stand. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Thank you all for coming. We're excited to have Nydia Tisdale with us tonight. She is over in the corner filming. She has her own. Tell us real quickly what you do, Nydia. Can you tell us and film at the same time?
Yes, Ginger. I video record public meetings of public interest, and I post them on my YouTube channel, and I also put them on Twitter and Facebook.
Okay,
and media.
Great. So excellent. People can follow you.
Absolutely.
Okay,
yes.
So tell us what that is to follow you.
My Twitter account is at Nydia Tisdale.
Okay.
It's spelled N-Y-D-I-A.
Okay.
T-I-S-D-A-L-E.
Okay.
And my Facebook handle is aboutforsyth.com.
Okay.
And I also have a blog called aboutforsyth.com.
Great. All right. Did everybody get that? Thank you. So, Nydia, thank you for coming tonight. Thank you, Jim, for asking her. I'm going to let Dave, I'll let you talk at the end if you want to,
sure,
if that's
great,
okay. And if anybody else has an announcement, we have a faith and freedom announcement. But I want to, without further ado, tell y'all that I'm so excited. I love when women get involved. I love you men, too, when you get involved in politics. Don't get me wrong. Please don't get me wrong. I'm an equal opportunity lover. But I especially love when wonderful, servant-hearted, godly women decide to put themselves on the chopping block, so to speak, and run for office, because it is not easy, whether you're running for state house rep or whether you're running for national committee woman or whatever you're running for. When you put your name out there, it is sometimes all hell breaks loose, but it's worth it. And Deborah Silcox decided to do that last year in November. She ran for House District 52, which was formerly Joe Wilkinson's seat, and it's Buckhead and Sandy Springs. She was just sworn in January the 9th, and so I thought I want her to come and talk to us about what it's like being a freshman. Tell us what she's working on. Tell us what her heart pulse issues are. And she said today that today was her most exciting day yet. And I said, we want to hear every ounce of what you're telling us. So y'all give a warm welcome to Deborah Silcox.
Ginger, so much for this opportunity. I just really feel privileged to come before this group, especially the one that's headed by the National Republican Committee woman. My goodness, Prophet Ginger. And I would be remiss if I did not also tell y'all that Marion Brawbeer helped me so much in my campaign. I know she's been a big part of the group. But again, my name is Deborah Silcox. I grew up here in Sandy Springs, I like to say, when it was out of the country. Because Johnson's Ferry was a two-lane road then. There was no perimeter mall. 285, they were finishing. It was a different place than it is today with Mercedes-Benz headquarters going in and skyscrapers going up. And it was a different place. But I grew up there, and I went to Riverwood High School. I went to the University of Georgia undergrad. Go Dogs.
Yay!
And then I went to Emory Law School. But as a senior in high school, I actually had, I had cancer. And I had been in my high school pageant. I'd done well. And I had entered the junior Miss pageant, and I went to the officials and said, I found out that I have cancer, and I'm going to have chemotherapy and radiation. I'm going to lose my hair. Can I still be in your pageant? They said, absolutely. And so I did all those things, but I did win the pageant. And I'll tell you that the Lord just took me through that experience. He lifted me up. They were supposed to amputate my left leg. And praise God, I kept my left leg. Wasn't supposed to be able to have children because I had chemotherapy and radiation. But I have two beautiful, perfect children. Of course, they're perfect, they're mine. So I'm just so, so blessed. But because of that experience, it changed my life forever. And I've been in some sort of public service ever since then. And so I did practice law for 10 years and gave up partnership to stay home with my children. But while I was home with them, I helped start the Chastain Park Conservancy Group. I was on the board for the Atlanta Speech School, the Junior League of Atlanta, Hands-On Georgia, had the privilege of serving for Governor Sonny Perdue on the Department of Human Resources Board, as well as for Governor Deal on the Governor's Commission for Volunteerism and Service, where I was chair. So just was very active, worked on a number of campaigns for both the Bush campaigns, as well as Representative Beth Eskin's campaigns. And I'm just delighted to have this opportunity to serve. I truly am. I had talked to Joe Wilkinson for years about this, and he, you know, is a cancer survivor also. And he wasn't sure if he was going to run, but he had a great checkup, so he did qualify. He called me on the Wednesday of qualifying and said, "You need to come down." And I said, "Oh, Joe, you're just joking. That's rumor." So no, this is for real. Somebody's going to challenge me. And so I was kind of baptized by fire the Friday of qualifying, because my opponent went in literally with 15 minutes left to spare at 11:45. So I had to go in right behind him. The primary was very difficult. All the political establishment was against me. They were all for my opponent, including the mayor of Sandy Springs, who was my opponent's political consultant. I just really worked my fanny off. Mary knows I worked 16 hours a day for the entire primary, and was fortunate to win the race by 151 votes, which I am not taking for granted. So the next time you go, oh, it doesn't matter if I vote. It doesn't matter. It matters. Every vote matters. So if you have an opportunity to vote for any office, go and vote, because the apathy is huge out there, you guys. And especially in May, when people are thinking about Memorial Day and going to the beach and get out of school, you know, I'm going, please go and vote. Please go vote in the primary. So it really is important. And what you're doing here as part of the Republican Party is very important, to be active, to know what's going on in your community, and to be involved. Because leadership matters. I mean, you guys can testify in your businesses, in your homes, in your churches, leadership matters. And so I would just applaud you for your involvement in this group. And again, just appreciate so much the chance to come and speak to you. As Ginger said, I was sworn in on January 9th, and we got off to a great start. We reelected the Speaker of the House, the Speaker Pro Tem. The Speaker Pro Tem, I'll tell you, Jan Jones, has been especially kind to me, And we are so fortunate to have Jan Jennings in the legislature. She is such a servant herself and is a fine, she has her own business, she has her MBA, she passed the first legislation for charter schools in Georgia. She is a real gem. So we re-elected those guys. We heard the state of the state, and we did pass the amended budget, which is really an adjustment. And I brought some notes because there's some really good things in this mid-year budget. It represents a 2.5 increase over the fiscal 2017 budget, which was $606.2 million. It includes an adjustment for growth in K-12 enrollment of $11.2 million. It includes a transfer of $5 million into the governor's emergency fund to help the communities in Albany and South Georgia that were so adversely affected by the storms down there. It also includes, really exciting to me, a $50 million appropriation for a state-owned cybersecurity research and training center in Augusta. And I didn't know anything about this, you guys, but cybersecurity, of course, is such a huge business nationwide, and we have at Fort Gordon in Augusta an incredible cybersecurity facility already. And what this money is going to be appropriated for is bringing in students to train new people so that there are more trained people to take these types of jobs to protect corporations and private entities in Georgia. And so I just think this is a great incubator for more great jobs in Georgia, and was really excited to hear about that. Another item we're going to take up probably in the next few days is it's called the bed tax, but that really is a misnomer. It's really a provider fee on the hospitals, and people go, gosh, what are they going to spend on that money? But by us renewing that provider fee, in exchange, we will draw down almost completely double the amount of federal funds that we receive from the feds in exchange for that provider fee. So even though this is a burdensome for the hospitals, at the same time, it brings in almost double the amount of federal revenue. So I think particularly until Washington can decide what we're going to do about Obamacare, I think it's critical for the stability of the hospitals in our state to vote this provider fee to review it. Today was day 13 of the legislative session, and we did also pass last week an adjournment resolution, which for one of the first times, Dan, you tell me, that we actually have a schedule. The leadership has worked out a schedule, so we know that sine die, the last day of the session, is going to be March 30th. Which I think is a huge improvement because people can plan their lives. And you know, they can go back to their businesses, they can make arrangements with their families for vacations, and so I think it's great to know, not only for the legislators, but for the general public. People like Dave, who are down there all the time, can plan their schedules accordingly too. So I thought that was great. But today, as Ginger said, was my best day, and that's because we had our first real substantive hearing. One of the committees that I've been assigned to is the Health and Human Services Committee, and number one being a cancer survivor, number two being married to an orthopedic surgeon, number three with Northside Hospital being the largest employer in the district. I have a lot of interest in health in Georgia. And we had a bill today that was brought by the optometrist. And the optometrist wanted to expand basically their scope of practice to include injections in people's eye. And there was a lot of controversy. I did a lot of research over the weekend, talked to a lot of experts. And I'm very happy to say that the bill was defeated by committee 12 to 11. And this was a very tough thing to do because this was the majority leader, John Meadows, this was his bill. Him and Representative Earl Earhart, who were both very well-respected, influential men. And as a baby legislator, I had to go to both of them. Actually, Representative Earhart came to me, but I had to go to Chairman Meadows and say, you know, these are the reasons, I've done my homework, and these are the reasons why this is bad for people, for patients in Georgia, because the amount of training that people as optometrists do doesn't even compare. I mean, literally, ophthalmologists receive almost 10 times more training to do this type of thing. And so and they do 4 more years of schooling. And so I felt very fortunate that, again, with my background and my husband's background, that I was able to bring something to the table. And arguably, I had the deciding vote, you guys.
Wow.
We had testimony starting at 2 o'clock, and we didn't get out till about 5. And it was very hard fought because the very influential people involved. But I was very excited and very charged that I did my homework and I was able to face the music and vote my conviction. I'm also on the non-civil judiciary committee. And non-civil basically covers a lot of criminal matters. And certainly with my background on the Governor's Commission and all, I am very interested in pursuing and continuing the governor's wonderful work in the area of criminal justice reform for nonviolent offenders. We have the largest number of people of any state on probation right now in Georgia, which is really a problem. And I would love to see these kids that are, again, they're nonviolent offenders, go to accountability courts, which the governor set up and consequently, because these children, a lot of them don't have a good home situation. And so the fact that they have to go before a judge in these accountability courts and be accountable for what they've done in terms of their probation, what have you, it really has helped a lot of these young people get back on their feet. And I think it's a win for the taxpayers because we're reducing our prison populations. But most importantly, it's a win for these young people that perhaps have made a mistake, but again, nonviolent, and hopefully we can rehabilitate them so they can be productive citizens in Georgia. So excited about being on that committee. And then finally, the last committee I'm on is State Planning and Community Affairs, and we're going to have our first meeting tomorrow afternoon at 2 o'clock. Would encourage y'all, if you haven't looked at the Georgia House of Representatives website, you can go on there, and all committee meetings are live. They'll stream live on your computer if you're interested in a particular bill or a committee. You can watch it live. If you want to find a bill and you don't know what bill number it is, you can look at other people that are associated with that bill. You can search my name, my last name, or any of the representatives' last names, and find who's involved with that bill. There are just tons of ways that you can search it as well by title on there. But would encourage you to, if you are concerned about legislation coming up, to voice your opinion. I've already gotten probably 300 or 400 emails from constituents, some people in this neighborhood, and actually I've gotten a lot of emails about House Bill 144, which is about pet store owners. There are a lot of people in this district that are not in favor of these, they call them puppy factories or kitten factories, where there are too many animals produced. And I've had some people in Buckhead and Sandy Springs say that they were really against this. And so I've already talked to some of the signers on that bill to say, I'm going to have to vote my constituency. I've gotten a lot of emails because there are a lot of people in this area that think it's inhumane to have this many animals, and we have already too many animals running around. So it's everything I thought it would be. You guys, more down there. There's a lot of great people, I will say, that people have been extremely welcoming. People have been extremely kind to me down there, and I did not necessarily expect that. And you know, everybody comes from different backgrounds and different educational levels. But it takes all parts of the body, of course, to make things work. And I have to say that every person I've met down there, regardless of party, really is interested in the best for the state of Georgia. And I think we're very fortunate to have Governor Deal in place. He has done a tremendous job. He I think he's underrated, you guys. I really do.
Okay,
I really do. I think he, for example, when he started office in 2010, there was only 2 days of fiscal reserves left to run the state of Georgia. 2 days. And he has built that rainy day fund up to $2 billion, which is about 2 months worth of running the state. And you know, we have kept our AAA bond rating all the way through the recession. There are only six states in the country that have a AAA bond rating, so it cost us less on the loans that we have and bonds that we have out. He is just a tremendous leader in so many ways. And again, with Speaker Ralston and Speaker Pro Tem have been so, so kind to me and just been really welcoming. And I've just really enjoyed it. And again, I'm just delighted to serve. Would be glad to get your input and write to me. If you want to come see me, my office is right across the street from the Capitol. I'm in the Coverdale Legislative Office Building in room 404D, as in Deborah. And you can look at my phone number, of course, and email on the legislative website as well. So, y'all have any questions or? Linda, yes.
Did you mention what you are putting forth?
I did not. I appreciate you asking that. And it's been very interesting because some things that I have wanted to put forth, I haven't had the opportunity to do yet, but I've already been given a lot of committee work. And one of the bills that I'm working on is a child hearsay statute. And it basically, when the original bill was passed on this, they had the effective date of it incorrect because it was passed with a general criminal bill. And this would make the effective date the date that the governor signs it this year, and it would allow for more conviction rates for child molestation cases in particular. Because right now, because it was tacked on at the end of a session when it was passed before and the effective date was incorrect for the standards in the bill, a lot of defense attorneys have been able to use that as a tool to get people off, basically. And so this would correct this part of the statute so that it was not inconsistent. And
how did you find out about that?
A couple of DAs have written to me and said that this was a flaw in the law. And so I had an opportunity to research it and look at it and agreed with them. And so they're gonna come, a Cobb DA actually is gonna come down and testify about it. And I think it'll be an improvement to our criminal code.
And you mentioned the juvenile justice stuff, but there's been a lot of juvenile crime in this area that these kids are getting slaps on the wrist. And the one that really bothers me is the one that was in May this past year at the Chevron station, and it was a carjacking.
Right, and actually, Representative...
15-year-old was on his 16th crime.
Representative William Bode actually brought a bill this morning that addresses that very thing, and they call them slider crimes, where these kids slide in into a car at a gas station, slide out, and he has actually proposed a bill in the non-civil judiciary that would make it, because apparently right now, that is just viewed as a misdemeanor, and the reason that you're having repeats is because it's just a misdemeanor, and then they do it again, it's just a misdemeanor again. And so this bill would ramp it up, so it would be misdemeanor, yeah, and then it would be a felony, then it would be a more serious felony, it would go up to $100,000 fine.
I'd really like you to look into this particular situation that happened in Chevron, because a 15-year-old on crime number 16 is out of control.
Well, and a lot of these people, the police officers that testified this morning said that a lot of these people that are doing this are repeat offenders. It's the same group of people.
Right.
And as soon as they get into jail, they get out on bonds really easily. And I really think perhaps the bond system may be a part of the problem as well.
I think there's probably a lot. It could be the level of staffing in juvenile court. It could be the city of Atlanta, Fulton County is looking at the timing and that these crimes were not getting put on the docket fast enough so that they were out before the second one was showing up.
Exactly.
There's a lot of stuff here.
And, yeah.
Liz Hausman's office was looking into it.
That's great. I appreciate that. And Ashford, you had a question?
More or less, possible solution, a possible suggestion. If you haven't heard of the National Guard Challenge program, you may have already heard of that. If you have not, you could check with Craig Schwall or Roger Wise on that. It's a wonderful program for at-risk children who are at risk of being thrown out of high school. And it's done by the National Guard. They have two locations in Georgia. There's Fort Stewart and Fort Gordon. These kids are brought in. They're given military training in the morning and academics in the afternoon. They have a 98% success rate with kids. And they come out with their ASVAB, SAT, and ASVAB, SAT, and GED.
That's fantastic. That's fantastic.
So that would take some of that off of the...
Can we do that statewide?
Yeah. It is statewide.
No, but I mean, can we make it a bigger program? That would be great.
It is. It's very successful. There are other states that participate in it, yes.
Wasn't it the juvenile court judge that was onto that?
Yeah,
it was
Sammy Jones. He turned Craig onto it.
That's great. Thank you for that suggestion.
Anybody else have any more questions?
Down the Capitol, Deb was talking about her committee. I know there's two, I think there were House bills today. One was a bill, so make it illegal to take pictures of people under their clothing.
Yes.
And one was a bill to prohibit sexual contact between teachers and their students. And while I'm glad the General Assembly's addressing these things, it's like, isn't it sad that you all have to pass bills to have to tell people, don't do this?
Well, the really tough one on their kids not having sex, they had to broaden it from just teachers to students.
Yeah.
And they anybody that works with the school, because right. Apparently there have been problems with community coaches affiliated with the school, but not employed by the school,
right.
As well as staff people. So it's not just the teachers.
What is the purpose?
It's really to, instead of just saying there shouldn't be sex between teachers and students.
Right.
This says there shouldn't be sex between anybody that's affiliated with the school and students, which is an obvious thing to most people, but that's, like you said, it's a shame that somebody's having to draft a bill that says something that's so
They're
wrong.
They're just coaches. They coach the soccer team or the wrestling team.
They just come in like
They're the bigger offender than the teachers.
Well, and I know at my children's school, this was a concern brought by the administration on their errors and omissions insurance was, we keep having to bring in community coaches to cover all these teams, but they're not necessarily bought into the school's philosophy, and is this a good thing or not? But the schools are really wrestling with this because the demand to have enough teams to do all the sports. They can't hire enough people. They can't afford to hire enough people full time. So their hands are tied. They have to hire some community coaches. But then to get these people on board with their philosophy and all, there have been some issues. Yes.
That kind of reminds me of a while back, they had to pass a law in Georgia that said the crematories couldn't not do their job and throw people's loved ones in the woods until that happened. They had to pass a law about that.
Really?
Yeah, we've got actually two people in our freshman class are undertakers by profession. So we said they're starting their own undertakers caucus.
How many of you all looked up SB 51?
I mean, I don't recall which bill that is.
That was the one that was sitting on Facebook all Sunday afternoon. SB 51.
Yeah.
There were a lot of people who were looking up SB 51.
Okay.
And finally figured out that Super Bowl 51.
No way.
Very serious. Take a look at Todd Green.
Well, I'm just glad I didn't fall for that one.
What in the world is SB 51? And y'all have got to see what she can do about changing SB 51 from what it is currently. To some kind of resolution for the footnotes.
I'll have to pull this on to Senator Unterman or somebody.
Yeah. He should. That would be so funny.
SB 51.
That's a good one.
We really were looking it up. And something about signage for the film industry.
Oh, that's hilarious.
What?
That's hilarious.
It does need to be pulled.
Yes.
And put the resolution there for the office.
That's so funny. That's
yeah,
great.
Yeah, you can do that.
You can do that.
Absolutely, absolutely. Well, this has been my pleasure and delight. Thank you so much for coming today.
Happy birthday.
Happy birthday.
It was not a birthday.
Oh. My
birthday's
Halloween.
That was her best day.
It was,
I said,
and she said, it's not. I'm like, sure, please don't tell me you're coming to the Buckhead Republicans on your birthday. But we're so thankful for you, Deborah, and y'all, bring your prayers, because that's a hard work down there. Oh, Dave, do you have an announcement about Faith and Freedom? This is exciting.
Thanks, Ginger. Yeah, so I'm Dave Baker with Faith and Freedom Coalition. We're going to do
come up here.
Okay. Yeah, there we go. Thank you, Ginger. Hi, I'm Dave Baker with Faith and Freedom Coalition. We're going to do our annual legislative luncheon down at the Capitol a week from Thursday, February 16th at the Freight Depot. And our special guest will have leadership from House and Senate, state and federal, coming to speak to us. But our special guest speaker will be author, speaker, and Fox News radio host Todd Starnes.
And he's wonderful.
And Todd will be talking about his new book, The Deplorable's Guide to Making America Great Again. So please join us. We're not using Eventbrite, we're using TicketSpice, which is like Eventbrite. But anyway, so I've got a couple flyers, but if you can join us at the Capitol a week from Thursday, we'd love to have you there. Thank you.
Thank you. And also, Robert, you want to stand up and tell what you're running for?
Right.
Oh, I was come up here, Robert. This is so exciting. I love Robert.
First of all, I want to thank all of you. I want to thank Ashford, Jim, Ginger. I want to thank Greg, everyone, Mrs. DeSantis. I joined officially. I say I got started last year in February. And Ashford held my hand, he got me involved with Circle R and everything. I saw Greg and Jim, they always made me feel welcome. I met this lovely young lady, and probably it was here or somewhere else, and then she wound up being at the convention. So every time, and I met Ms. DeSantis, and every time I would say something, oh, you're going to run for office, you're going to run for office. Nah, I have no idea. I wanted to run for office, but I appreciate you all. So yes. The city of South Fulton got voted in November of last year. I agree. And I was tossing it around, and January, I decided for certain I wanted to run for mayor. But it was this loony thing, you have to qualify. And I was like, oh my God, I have no idea what the qualifications are. So I wonder if I qualify or not. So I went downtown to Fulton County election and registration, and she said, you have your check? Yeah, I have my check. Mm-hmm. Oh, then you qualify. So yes, my name is officially in the hat for mayor of the city of South Fulton. I want to thank you all, I love you all, and I thank God for you. Oh, yes. So,
back up here, right? Okay. Now, first off, you qualify. When is the election?
The election is the early vote is February 27th, and our primary is March 21st. It's a special election.
So, early vote. Who is on your campaign staff, and what can the people in this room do to assist you? How many votes do you need to win?
We have 86,000 people there. So things like getting a list from Fulton County, I need help with. And I'll be honest with you all.
Do you have a committee?
I have a campaign committee. It's my mother and my father. So I do need your help.
Okay.
I am new to this. I will be candid with you.
Okay. How many qualified?
There are 9 qualified candidates for mayor.
Okay. Well then, why don't you pass around a list to get the names of the folks who are here that were willing to help you.
Okay.
And here's his flyer, but yeah, Robert has been wonderful, and he's been a great member of our club, and he's
and your website is?
I voted for Bohler. F-O-R-B-O-N-N-E-R. I voted for Bonner.com.
Okay, all right, so thank you, Robert. We're proud of you for running. Is there anybody else that has an announcement tonight?
I guess more.
All right, well, if you haven't joined our club, it's $25, but if you've joined and it's time to renew, it's $15. If you're a couple, it's $35. But if you're renewing, it's $20. Anything else? Okay, thank y'all for coming. We'll see y'all next month. We think we're having all the chairs to all the candidates. Our next meeting is March the 14th, which is a Tuesday, and we have an invitation out to Alex Johnson, Michael McNeely, John Watson, and Mike Welch, who are the four candidates running for. This is going to be online, so everybody get these guys here because we're going to have a forum for them to come next week. We're going to partner with the Fulton County Republican Party, so we're going to have a huge crowd, and we're going to find out about these guys that want to be the chairman of the Republican Party in Georgia. So March 14th, mark your calendars, bring a friend, bring your aunt, bring your uncle, bring your grandmama, bring everybody. All right, thank you.